Welcome to Healthcare Data Analytics, Patient Identification. This is Lecture B. This component covers the topic of healthcare data analytics, which applies the use of data, statistical and quantitative analysis, and explanatory and predictive models to drive decisions and actions in healthcare. The learning objectives for this unit, Patient Identification, are define the key attributes of patient identifiers, describe the challenges of duplicate and overlaid records, discuss the pros and cons of standard identifiers versus linking records, describe the methods used for patient record matching, match a sample set of patient records, and discuss the benefits and limitations of de-identified data. In the previous lecture of this unit, we talked about patient identifiers, duplicate and overlaid records, standard identifiers, and record linkage methods. In this lecture, we'll discuss the value and limitations of the de-identification of data. De-identified health information is health data from which information that could be used to identify an individual has been removed. There are two accepted methods under HIPAA for data to be de-identified. One is to remove the 18 elements of protected health information, which are listed at the link provided here. The other is the statistical de-identification by a person with appropriate knowledge of and experience with generally accepted statistical and scientific principles and methods for rendering information not individually identifiable. Health information that has been de-identified is not subject to the HIPAA privacy rule. However, it is still useful. De-identified health information can be used in research and other aggregations. So if health data has been de-identified, that means the identities of the individuals whose data it is are secure, right? Not necessarily. Research done by Sweeney and colleagues found, for example, that 87% of the U.S. population can be uniquely identified by using as few as three data elements: the five-digit zip code of where they live, their gender, and their date of birth. Think about that for a minute. If someone has just these three pieces of data, they can identify the individual to whom it belongs 87% of the time. In some additional early work by Sweeney in 1997, she showed that after spending $20 to purchase a voter registration list for Cambridge, Massachusetts, she was able to identify the governor of Massachusetts, William Weld, in a health insurance database for state employees simply by linking zip code, gender, and date of birth from the voter registration list to the de-identified health data in the health insurance database. We'll talk more about this on the next slide, but it must be noted that recent reanalysis of the population demographics found the fact that Mr. Weld was a public figure who experienced a much-publicized hospitalization played a part in his being so easily identifiable in the insurance database. However, in 2013, using voter registration data of participants in the Massachusetts-based Personal Genome Project, Sweeney was also able to show that people who have agreed to have their genomic data published are relatively easily identified individually using that voter registration data. The figure on this slide shows how the medical information about Governor Weld was re-identified. To the left is the de-identified medical database. It has various medical data, including diagnoses, procedures, medications, etc. It also has the de-identified person's zip code, date of birth, and gender. This latter information is also in the voter registration database on the right, which also has the individual's name and address, not to mention some voting-related information. This demonstrates how the governor's medical data was discovered. There are other examples of re-identification from de-identified data. A couple analyses have found that genomic data can help re-identify patients who are in databases of clinical research studies. Aquisti found that Social Security numbers can sometimes be predicted from public data sets. Simino and colleagues have looked at chronominization of laboratory data. In other words, taking the panels of test results where the combinations of values are likely to be unique and using this to then re-identify patients. Credit card data also turns out to be a source of re-identification of data, with one analysis looking at 1.1 million people over 3 months and finding that 90% could be re-identified with only four of what they call spatiotemporal points, so knowing where and when the credit card was used. Clearly, there are many ways to re-identify supposedly de-identified data. It's also important to remember that when we de-identify data, there are a number of issues. It's not necessarily a panacea. First of all, we know that complete 100% de-identification is difficult, if not impossible, to achieve. So if we can't achieve complete success at de-identifying data, how much accuracy is acceptable? We also know that some personal health information elements may be more acceptable to not having. For example, parts of street addresses which sometimes fall through programs that aim to de-identify data, versus say names, which we probably want to be absolutely sure never pass through. By the same token, when we overscrub the data, in other words, when we remove identifiers, we may end up eliminating data that's important to the analysis being done, whether it's research or quality measurement, etc. When we de-identify data, we may eliminate things like temporal information. We may de-link the various healthcare episodes that a patient has had, and this information may be important in longitudinal analysis. In addition, we may undermine the accuracy of techniques, such as machine learning and natural language processing that operate on this data. When it's de-identified, we don't know how that affects the accuracy of these computational processes. The internet may be particularly problematic for maintaining privacy. There are so-called recreational genetic genealogy databases that allow identification of personal genomes when that data is combined with other data, such as age, name, and state. One analysis found that over 3/4 of those who post on medical web forums who thought they were posting anonymously could be re-identified by text analysis. Another well-known study looked at likes from various Facebook users and found that individual traits such as sexual orientation, political affiliation, personality types, and ethnicity could easily be gleaned from them. It is also known that many websites, including high-profile health websites, track user searches and sell that information to third-party tracking entities, usually for advertising or potentially for other purposes. There are few laws and regulations that govern such use. This is why, for example, you may be surfing the web and see an ad on a page that may be relevant to something you've recently been shopping for or looking at. Finally, there's the proliferation of health-related smartphone apps, with one assessment of the 600 most commonly used health-related smartphone apps finding that only 31% of them had privacy policies. This concludes Lecture B of Patient Identification. In this lecture, we defined what de-identified data is, described the two methods under HIPAA for de-identifying data, examined why de-identified data isn't necessarily secure data, explored some of the issues with de-identified data, and identified problems maintaining privacy while on the internet. This also concludes our unit on patient identification. In this unit, we saw that patient identifiers, including national identifiers, have benefits and risks. Methods for linking patient records algorithmically work well, but can be challenged by data standard, data quality, and inconclusive matches. De-identified patient data can be useful, but has some risk of re-identification and may have limits in its clinical value.